नाउ गोइंग लाइव।
ओके, सो
वेट
आई एम गोइंग टू स्टार्ट, राइट?
वेट वेट फॉर 10 सेकेंड्स। या यू कैन स्टार्ट नाउ।
ओके, सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल लेट मी मेक इट श्योर, एम आई ऑडिबल टू ऑल?
यस
यस। ओके, सो ए वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल। सो आई कुड सी दैट द ऑर्गेनाइजर्स ऑफ द आईपीए इंडियन फिजिक्स एसोसिएशन आर हेयर, मे स्पेशली प्रोफेसर वंदना नानन एंड प्रोफेसर तनुश्री साहा दास गुप्ता मैडम, वेलकम टू आवर डिपार्टमेंट। रेस्पेक्टेड टुडे स्पीकर प्रोफेसर समीर कुमार पारसा, respected faculty members of various other departments of Dibrugarh University and other institutions who are joining through Zoom as well as YouTube live streaming today. Respected faculty members of the Department of Physics, Dibrugarh University, who is the host of the today's event, dear students and research scholars, myself, Bulumani Kolita, assistant professor in the Department of Physics, Dibrugarh University. I, on the behalf of the organizers and host, welcome you all to the first online lecture of the colloquium series organized by the Indian Physics Association. So now I would like to request Professor Tanushree Saha Das Gupta Madam, Vice President of IPA, to give the opening remarks. Before that, let me briefly introduce Madam to you. Professor Das Gupta Madam is a senior professor in S.N. Bose National Center for Basic Sciences, Kolkata. She is a renowned physicist in India. She is from the Department of Condensed Matter Physics and Material Sciences. She works in the field of computational material physics, mainly electronic structure calculations. She is a Swarna Jayanti Fellow. She is also a Fellow of the World Academy of Science 2019, American Physical Society 2015, Indian Academy of Sciences Bangalore 2010, National Academy of Sciences India 2010. So with this brief introduction, I would like to welcome Professor Madam to give the welcome remarks. Over to you, Madam.
Thank you very much. Thank you for this kind introduction. And this is actually a very happy moment for me because I'm present in a colloquium in which the speaker is one of my colleague and also collaborator. And the chairman of our governing body is also present in this meeting. So it's a really rare occasion. So I would just like to start by saying few words, giving some very brief introduction about IPA, about a minute or so. Of course, IPA has a long history and it will take quite a bit of time if I want to really describe all details. So I just, instead of that, I just want to share with you a 1 minute kind of very brief description of its activity. So I'm going to share the screen. Just tell me whether you can see it all well. Can you see my screen?
Yeah.
Yeah, so Indian Physics Association was founded long ago in the year 1970. And there is a YouTube link where you can actually get some more details about it. And the primary goal of Indian Physics Association was to help the advancement, dissemination and application of knowledge of physics. And it has basically resorted to various different modes to do that. First is, of course, the publication of bulletins, reports, and newsletters. And one of the key bulletin or the publication from Indian Physics Association is Physics News. And what you see here is actually a very recent issue, which has been devoted to the famous women scientist, Biba Chowdhury. And there are many interesting articles, and it is available online. So I would urge you to have a look on it. Other than that, IPA is engaged in arranging seminars. Students, teachers, and young researchers. And among the special lectures, the noteworthy one are DAE C.P. Raman lecture series, IPA, IOP, Homi Bhabha, Cockcroft Walton exchange lecture, where basically the Indian lecturers, they go to UK and deliver lecture, and the scientists from UK also come through this exchange program to deliver lectures in India. Professor P.A. Pandya Endowment Lecture, partnership and sponsorship with conferences. So it also jointly with other organization organizes conferences. Webinar series New Horizons in Physics, which is also available in YouTube. And there are different chapters of IPA, although the main center is hosted in Jaipur. And you can see actually it is all over India. It also arranges for awards for recognition of senior and young scientists. And it has a liaison with national and international societies, all other physical societies all around the world. So it has a very strong presence on that. With that few words, I welcome the speaker of today and looking forward to a very, very interesting talk and on a very interesting theme, which was that of the technology innovation and the application, which was actually an idea. I must thank also Dr. Jagatap, who is present in this lecture, because it was primarily his motivation, and this was a wonderful idea. We immediately tried to, you know, go by his suggestion, because we all felt this is a brilliant idea. So I'm looking forward to the talk. Thank you so much.
Bulumani, you are muted.
Okay. So am I audible now?
Yes.
Okay. So thank you, madam. Now I move toward the head of the Department of Physics, Dibrugarh University, Dr. Prashant Kumar Hoikia, sir. He basically is involved in the research area of experimental condensed matter physics. So I would like to invite you, sir, to give some remarks as a host. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon. Respected organizers, respected speaker, Prof. Samir Kumar Pal, respected faculty members, research scholars, and students, and respected participants from the other departments and offices. We are happy to host IPA Colloquium at Applied Basic Research for Atmanirbhar Bharat in the Department of Physics, by the Department of Physics. The Department of Physics was established in 1967 under the Dibrugarh University. It has a tradition of teaching and research. The department aims to provide quality education in physics, both at the graduate and postgraduate level, to create an atmosphere for the creation of new knowledge through methodical research. The department regularly hosts and interacts with visitors, national workshops, and research seminars. Currently, the department has 18 faculty members. The department offers the following academic programs, basically a five-year integrated program in physics, two-year MSc in physics, MPhil program, then in physics, PhD in physics, and postdoctoral in physics. The department basically primarily research is going on different areas of physics, basically condensed matter physics. In the condensed matter physics, characterization and preparation and characterization of the different materials, nanostructured material, solid gel glasses, and thin film solar cells. And under branch is atmospheric physics and space physics. In that branch, also the research is going on in different ways. And also one branch, astrophysics and cosmology and high energy physics. In that physics, gamma rays, astronomy, Gibson wave, then astrophysics, cosmology and high energy physics. The under branch of research is electronics, and in the branch, electronic group also work for different antenna design, etc. This is the missing different areas of research in different areas in physics where the active research in is going on. The researchers, basically, around more than 30 students are doing pursuing their PhD in this department for their PhD degree. Also, there are more than 10 numbers of MPhil students are pursuing their for their MPhil degree. This is our in brief. This is for the development. And also, student number of students intake is around 160 in. Integrated MSc, there are 100 seats are there, and also in MSc there are 33 numbers of seats in each year. There year, as a whole, 66 seats are available for the students in the both the years. So thank you. This is about the Department of Physics in brief. Okay, we are very happy to actually. Get this opportunity to host this IPA colloquium and to interact with the Indian Physics Association and also TIFR. Okay, we are very happy to interact with this TIFR. Though it's online, we think that this like this program also benefited like offline courses. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. So now, without delay, we'd like to move towards the today's lecture. Before starting, we'd like to request the participants to raise their queries in the chat box panel of the Zoom platform or in the YouTube live streaming. We will take the queries at the end of the lecture. So the title of today's lecture is Application Drive and Basic Research for Atmanirbhar Bharat. It will be delivered by Professor Samir Kumar Pal, sir of S.N. Bose National Center for Basic Sciences, Kolkata. He is a senior professor in the Department of Chemical, Biological, and Macromolecular Sciences. After obtaining the PhD degree in physics from Indian Association of Cultivation of Sciences in 2000, Professor Pal, sir moved to California Institute of Technology to work with Professor Ahmed H. Jewil till the end of 2003. We should mention here that Professor Jewil, with whom Professor Palser worked, received Nobel Prize in Chemistry in the year 1999. Professor Pal is an elected fellow of Indian National Academy of Engineering, FNAE, 2020. He received the National Academy of Sciences India and Reliance Industries Platinum Jubilee Award for Application-Oriented Innovations in Physical Science, 2020. He is an owner of Abdul Kalam Technology Innovation National Fellowship 2018. He is also a recipient of UK India Education and Research Initiative UKRI Nanotechnology Award 2007 and many more. There are large numbers of publications in journals of high repute as well as significant number of patents to his credit. So with this brief introduction, I would like to request Professor Samir Kumar Pal sir to deliver the lecture. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kalita Bulumoni. So yesterday we met together. So today I'll be talking, about this. This thing. So like application-driven basic research for Atmanirbhar Bharat. So title itself made lots of confusion, I hope, because so far the Atmanirbhar Bharat mission of Government of India is concerned. Every day we are receiving lots of office memorandum that purchase should be done like this way, that way. So our purchase department is a little bit confused, and this is our duty as a purchase committee member to clarify that this is nothing other than we have to become Atmanirbhar. So that was like only thing that we have to tell this thing like that. So this is really a confusion. And as you know, that this is like the era, like today, where the COVID-19 is hitting. This is also an era of confusion with lots of stuff, like how to address how to teach even students over online, and also how to teach the practical courses online. And that, as Bulumoni said, that you know, that some thing is going on, that how to do the experiment with a smartphone, science, so forth. But before I start something, let me thank to one person. For him, I am just sitting in front of you, not standing right now. So he is none other than Professor Jagata. So he came to our lab, and our students, it was so inspired. Sir, let me convey my deep regards. And also I will show a few snapshots that happened during our interaction, you know, during your visit to our lab. So that I will do. But, you know, as I told you, that let me start with cleaning a confusion one by one. And one of the great confusion is like that I am from S.N. Bose National Center for Basic Sciences, which is a DST Autonomous Institute established in 1986. And what is the confusion? Confusion is very simple. Like, not only in abroad, wherever I go, including, you know, Bulumoni State, like I said with a big, you know, with a smile that I am from S.N. Bose National Center, and people nod their head like that, oh, you are from Bose Institute. Then I had to nod my head, you know, horizontally, and said, no, I'm from Bose, S.N. Bose National Center. So this is really confusion, that which Bose is the Bose of S.N. Bose National Center. And why the confusion? Confusion is the following. Like, if you land to our airport, so there is a Bose called Netaji Subhas Bose. So our airport is named after him, and he's a freedom fighter. Then we have a Professor J.C. Bose. J.C. Bose, Bose Institute is named after him. We have S.N. Bose. S.N. Bose National Center is named after him. We have Jyoti Bose, who expired recently, and who was the chief, you know, chief minister for a long time, something like that. So Bose is really, and there is also a Bose speaker, like a related to audio, that is also Bose. So which Bose is related to S.N. Bose? Sometimes it is like a confusion. Let me clarify this issue first. So you see that this is the picture of James of, you know, galaxy of James. They are brilliant people at the time. And you can see Professor J.C. Bose, Bose Institute is named after him. Although he was a biophysicist, he's from physics, but many people were confused that he was from biology. So he discovered many things. Recently, you know, a Royal Society gave a verdict that this is not a G. Marconi, this is the Professor J.C. Bose who discovered the radio wave. So it was like Professor J.C. Bose. But what was interesting part of your research that it touched to my heart is something discovering life in plants. So that was very, very interesting. And why it is interesting? Let me tell you that, you know, after his discovery, all the vegetarian become very, very sad, because earlier they thought that they are eating something and not killing life, something like that. Only non-veg person are eating and killing the life. But after his discovery, completely game changing, because he find the lives in plants. So that means whoever is the vegetarian, they are also killing the lives. So that was there. And he has a very good friendship with Professor APC, Acharya Prafulla Chandra Ray, who was the first entrepreneur of my country. And he made Bengal Chemical, which is like a first pharmaceutical industries of my country. And why it is so, that was, I will just ask, come in the context of Atmanirbhar Bharat, something like that. But where is Professor S.N. Bose? So you see, the Professor S.N. Bose is here. So he was a very good student of Professor J.C. Bose, and also he was the student of Professor APC. So this Professor S.N. Bose is famous for Bose-Einstein condensation, and whatever photon that we see, whatever spectroscopy we do, or the light, you can see me through photon, and photon is in a class of boson. So that was like that. So Bose-Einstein condensation, he is famous for that kind of stuff. So that was there. Now, coming back to this Atmanirbhar Bharat, and science policy. Although a few weeks back, Professor Jagatap came and visited our institute and gave a fantastic talk on the science policy, that what should be the science policy and where the science should go, Indian science should go. So we learned a lot from there. But we, in my understanding, for example, let me quote Modi ji in last Science Congress proposed. So new India needs logical temperament to invent, disseminate, and technological solutions. And he clearly said to the student that, innovate, patent, produce, and prosper. So if you want to prosper, and that was a very good message to all my junior colleagues, that if you want to get a fund in the field, so if you want to really prosper, you have to innovate, you have to make a patent, and you have to produce. Like this, you have to commercialize that, that patent, and you have to bring it to the market. So something like that. It was very, very clear statement. And he said that this kind of logical temperament that my country needs. So something like that. Now, coming back to a little bit history, because sometimes I like the history of science. So let me tell you that there is a history of Atmanirbhar Bharat, for example. And in about 1900, there was a movement called Swadeshi and Boycott Movement. What was the movement about? About like Atmanirbhar, like a, we have to be self-reliant kind of stuff. So if, so people easily used to throw everything, like their clothes, their shoes, which was made in UK or new, made in USA, to the fire and burnt it, something like that. That movement was called Swadeshi and Boycott Movement. But, in few days, it was clear that there is little or no response in boycotting British medicine that was there. Because if you are in sense, if you are in conscious, then you can throw your stuff and you can burn something like that. But if you are unconscious, if you are going to the hospital, then doctor is using some medicine. That medicine was not made by Indian people. So that was the British medicine. So that problem was first felt by APC, Acharya Prafulla Chandra Roy, and he established Bengal Chemical in 1901. So that was very fantastic stuff. So this, and after 17, that was his statement. He said the independence in technology is the key for the real freedom. Like in one end, you are just thinking to eradicate British, in an other end, you are just using their product. It is not possible. So first become independent in technology and talk about the freedom. So that was their statement. Then after 17 years, the same thing was uttered by our, father of our nation, like a Gandhiji. So what Gandhiji floated one Khadi movement, the basic idea of the Khadi movement was something like what APC and Professor, Professor APC and Gandhiji was very good friend. So you can see the picture over there. And Gandhiji even said that I am convinced that Swaraj cannot come so long as tens of millions of our brother and sister do not take charka, do not spin, do not make khadi and wear it. So that was their stuff. Because we had lots of materials for the cloth, but we didn't know how to weave. So that was this point. So he said that this is the symbol. Charka is the symbol for self-reliance. And he said the real independence will be like a symbol of self-reliance, self-government is the real independence, something like that. Now, in the today, if I ask you, even now, are we independent? And if there is some smart people, they can ask that which field. So if you, if I ask that in food, they will say, yes, we have lots of agriculture that we can, we will be independent in food. We are independent in dress, like a roti, kapra, makan, no problem with that. We can be independent without any help from external bodies. We can be independent. But the good question is coming, the energy. So are we independent in the field of energy? So that was the question. You know, people may say that if fossil fuel is concerned, we are independent 49% because Bombay High is making lots of fossil fuel. But let me tell you the catalyst which is normally used, because fossil fuel cannot be used as is to the truck or the bus or the car, something like that. It has to be converted to petrol or the diesel or the kerosene. So the catalyst that we'll be needing to convert the fossil fuel to this kind of usable fuel, that is not made in India. So it is either coming from 3M, from somewhere it is coming, and sometimes advisor of Bharat Petroleum and everything, the technical expert committee, I came to know that these are very expensive and it is coming over there. And without these catalysts, nothing can be converted. No, nothing can be converted to the real stuff. So the good, another question is that, are we independent in healthcare sector? So this is also a very good question. And the reflection you see that whenever somebody is falling sick, or they are afraid of falling sick, for example, they are flying. Even during the COVID period, lots of famous people flied with the charter flight to London, to USA, and something like that, because they didn't have any faith on Indian treatment or Indian medical technology, because that was this problem. So that's why they are flying to India, to some other stuff. So that was also true. So this is the question, that whether we are independent or not. I think that answer I'm just leaving to this audience, that whether we are independent. So the Swadeshi technology, again, coming back to this Atmanirbhar Bharat, what our Prime Minister said, that it is make in India whatever you want to make, or even the technology is outside, make it over there so that our GDP can be increased. Our Chief Minister also said that instead of sending our talent, IT, most of the IT people are from Bengal. So she realized, and she wanted to make a Silicon Valley of Asia, there is a new town area close to Kolkata, Salt Lake. So she wanted to make a Silicon Valley of Asia over there, the same airport. But what is much more interesting, let me tell you, what our science minister said few years back. So he said that develop technologies for common man. So that was very, very interesting. And he requested all the scientific community to develop technology for the common man. And why it is so important and it is attracting for us, let me tell you that if you want to develop something for the common man, what you need to do, you need to know the need and practice of the common man. You cannot take a technology from outside and you cannot just start using it in the Indian context. No. So that's why this is very tricky suggestion, and that is somebody has to really understand. So let me give you some example that when the need was known, but practice of the common man was ignored in a technology, and that's why it was a failure technology, something like that. So few years back again, there is news in the Times of India, and it said that IIT Kanpur flashes rail bio toilet plan. So what was the fact? Because railway department decided to install a rail bio toilet over there. You see that there's a bio toilet, and using about 500 crore rupees. And that was a fantastic idea. Many people, whoever is going to abroad and something like that, they have used this thing in USA, in Europe, something like that. That was the fantastic stuff, like a rail bio toilet, other area also, like in portable toilet, they are using the bio toilet. And it was a successful. So what the rail bio toilet use, the bio toilet use the cold active bacteria, which is being collected from Antarctica. And it will convert the human garbage to air and the water and the gas, something like that. And it will be disinfected before discharging to the track. So the track will remain really clean and no problem with that. So what was the problem? So IIT Kanpur studied said that this is not for the frequent use. For example, if you use this kind of stuff, for your home, like in the morning time, we are putting all the garbage to the toilet, and this bacteria is getting time to convert it to water and the gas whole day. And the evening time, we are coming back from the office, then, you know, bacteria is getting recharged to eat it again, something like that. But if you just think a Rajdhani Express, like which is going to Howrah to Delhi, few people can see that bathroom is unoccupied, always occupied. Somebody is going, somebody is coming, somebody is coming, somebody is going, something like that. So now, in the context of the bacteria, as it is the living entity, if you ask him or the her to eat, sometimes it will refuse, something like that. So this is one of the causes. That's why it is not a very good idea to put bio toilet in railway. This is number one. But this is not the reason that why it was being failed, why the need, you know, practice was missed. So, you know, the Indian practice is something, whatever we will do, after that, we will throw it out. We are using our PPE kit and throwing it out on the road. We are eating chips, potato chips, throwing the packet outside. Whatever we are doing, ice cream and throwing the sticks outside, something like that. So what happened that in railway also, one of the official observed that we found more than 5 kilograms of gutkha sachet when the box was opened during the overrule. The official said, please cooperate, please cooperate. That means we had a habit to eat something, the gutkha sachet, and throwing it up in the toilet, something like that. And as a result, like if you want, then you can train the bacteria to eat the gutkha, because as it is coming from Antarctica to India, then gutkha eating training can be given. But gutkha sachet eating training, I think that it is impossible to give somebody. So that's why it was being clogged. And now the railway department is thinking to take all the bio toilet out, because in the technology, what was being missing the practice of the common man. So again, I'm coming, that developing something for the common man is not so easy. If you miss their practice, then it is going to be fail. So this is something. Now, let me give you the next example. This is also very interesting example. So 3 IITs, including IIT Bombay, I think, Kharagpur, IIT Bombay, and they 3 IITs joined hand to develop, for example, Google self-driving car. So this is a fantastic idea. And idea means that it is not like Uber or the Ola, that you have to tell the driver where to go and passcode, something like that. Not like that. It is like that. It will come, you seat it over there, and then it will drop you to the destination. No problem with that. But you will be surprised to know that why Google is not bringing this thing to the market, because it is waiting for India for the field trial. It said that if it works in India, they will bring it to the market. Because you see the statement of one person from IIT Bombay who said, if we can have a solution that can work in India, it will undoubtedly work anywhere in the world. So that means, you know, Indian road condition, as you know, it has cows, it has a monkey, it has a drunk driver, it has an illiterate driver, and everybody is saying, observe that traffic rule. So that means the rule is not for me, who is observing, that is for rule is for them. So that is with this condition, if the Google, driverless car works, that means that would be fantastic. So he was a little bit reserved to say that it will work anywhere in the world. I am extending my statement that it will work anywhere in the universe. Forget about the world. If something works in India, like this stuff, it will work in Mars, it will work in Moon, no problem with that, believe me. So with this kind of problem, like, you know, that people are doing like this, that you have to know the practice before bringing the technology, something like that, you can a little bit laugh. And you can think, okay, it could have been done in a different way, something like that. But some big disaster are also happening because of the compatibility problem, because we do not know the practice of the common man and then bringing that technology for the common man. So let me show this stuff. So I tested with yesterday, and she can read. So in Ahamiya also that it is similar like that. So it is like in Bengali, it is called Purlo Dui Shoddo Jato Deklo Na Kyo. That means two of the newborn were burnt alive and nobody cares. So a few years back, it happened to one of the hospital in my city, something like that. So what was the problem? Problem was like, this is called radiant warmer. So what is radiant warmer? When baby comes from the womb of their mother, they put it in a radiant warmer. This is the radiant warmer. You see the baby is sitting over there. So radiant warmer, because their body temperature remains a little bit less. So in order to increase the body temperature, they put it over there. And after some time, the body temperature become normal and something like that. So what happened that day, instead of one baby, three babies were taking the heat bath in the radiant warmer. That is the three babies over there. But the sensor was put on one of the babies like this. So what happened that day, the mother of the baby decided, so whoever is having sensor, decided to take the baby to the toilet. So, and then what she did, she took the sensor out and has thrown it outside over there. So as you know, as it is outside, the radiant warmer didn't know that whether it is put in the baby or it is outside. So radiant warmer increases temperature. Whenever it goes to 250 degree, two of them are burnt alive. So this is problem. So it is, the problem was very simple, like a very simple. And then after that, there was an investigation committee. Investigation committee said, it is the nurse is responsible. Nurse is said the doctors are responsible. Doctor said it is the parent is responsible. And parents said it is the guardian. I don't know. Well, who is the responsibility? But you know, I ask this question to my physics students or my engineer student, just can you really avoid your responsibility? Because this radiant warmer was not made in India. It is not made in India. It was a German radiant warmer. After that, I went to the hospital. Sometimes I teach the translational medicine over there. And I went, I found the German, it is the German. They brought the technology. And a German engineer or a German scientist cannot think of sharing one radiant warmer by two babies, forget about three, because in their country, cross infection and everything over there. But if it could have been designed by one of my students or somebody else, they can make a warning like, you know, whenever temperature goes to certain limit, there'll be pow, something like that. And all there is a lots of a protocol that can be followed like this. So this is the disaster that I want to share you, that if you just bring the technology and put it over there without knowing the practice of the common man, then you cannot develop the technology for the common man. That's why, you know, what Harshvardhan ji said, I really appreciate that this is the very tricky and most difficult part to develop something for the common person. So we have a brainstorming session, we invited the industry, we have different part news and something like that. And they said, tell us the solution, because that was the problem of our country. So what was the solution that they said? That it has to be a cross-disciplinary approach, not multidisciplinary. Multidisciplinary, they touch with each other, but cross-disciplinary, they are embedded. One field is being embedded to others, something like that. So, and this is the logo of my lab. It's called AOSL, called Applied Optical Spectroscopy Lab. So whatever we are doing over there, I will justify that we are really cross-disciplinary, something like that. So our main idea is to identify the application domain first, not like we are just developing something and looking for some application to justify our research, no. So first we just find this, where our research will be applied, something like that. And we do small research. So you see the gear. And this research, we are working as per our expertise in spectroscopy, nanoscience and technology, so something like that. So this is very, very important stuff that we are doing. So it is upside down, so inverse Fourier transform. So this is my group. this is my group, I think that few months back, I would say something like that. There we are just posing with the same dress and in the uniform, because with the collaboration with the NTRF, National Tea Research Foundation, we developed a machine that if you just give a drop of tea, it can tell that whether it is Darjeeling tea or not. Not only that, it will tell whether it is the Assam tea. Not only that, if it is the Darjeeling tea, how far the garden is from the Nepal border, because Nepal tea and Darjeeling tea has a cross infringement, something like that. So we have this kind of stuff. So we have a DNA quadrant, D for Darjeeling, N for Nepal, A for Assam. So we have a DNA quadrant that in which quadrant our data is coming, that means we can tell that, you know, which kind of stuff. NTRF was very happy, and then they took our prototype, and we are also very happy on that. So this picture was taken, let's say, few months back. This picture of my group is taken few months back, let's say. This picture was taken, let's say, few years back, something like that. So you see that somebody is present, somebody is absent. So till now, 30, 32 PhD students that they graduated from my group, they are all established across the globe. Somebody got really the permanent position in somewhere in USA, in Sweden, and something like that. So really, I'm proud, because they are saying only how is my group doing, something like that. So, but which is time independent, time invariant, I would say, is their expertise. Every moment you are invited to come to my lab, and you can see that they are working 15 PhD students, something like that. They are working, they are from physics, they are from chemistry, they are from biology, they are from technology, even the medical doctors, they are also doing the PhD with me. So that was the good point and time independent point of my group. So always you can find somebody over there. This is really cross-disciplinary, and I want to say, repeating again, that this is really beautiful. And they are top 2% in my country. They are fantastic students. Like if you talk to them, you will be impressed with them, something like that. Professor Jagatap also taught some of my students, and he was very impressed. I'll just give you the evidence that how impressed he was. I have evidence for that. So this is like this. So somebody may ask that, you know, what we are doing with a fantastic group? What is the group activity? So group activity in real sense, in physics sense, I say that we are exploring key molecular timescales. Key molecular timescales means by using ultrafast spectroscopy. Ultrafast, so this is the jargon. Don't go through that for the student, because Vandana particularly told that, Sameer, be careful. Your student will be, the audience will be from the different variety and for the students, so don't go to the deep level. So even I'm really afraid to put ultrafast spectroscopy. So what I'm going to do, what is the meaning of molecular time scale? I'm just citing one famous person's quotation. He is none other than Professor Feynman. So Professor Feynman said that whatever living things are doing, that can be understood in the jiggling, wiggling motions of the atom. So if you can understand the atomic motions very well, you can say that what a living things can do. So that was like the point that he made. So he's from Caltech. You know, after a few years, my advisor, who doesn't know Professor Zoell, please note that he is not Professor Zoell. He is me, and he is Professor Zoell. He's my teacher. So he said that dance is very, very important. Atomic dance or the molecular motions is very, very important, but that should not be a simple solo dance, what is happening in the. So one atom is dancing just in a solo dance, in a black, it is not like that. So these dance, which is in concerted dance, one atom is dancing in concertation with the other atoms. This is basically very, very important dance that was making life and death. And one interesting, important example that he uses to cite us is the oxygen molecule. You know, oxygen is a diatomic molecule. Whenever their spin is in a triplet state, then that was a beautiful molecule in the world. All the living beings are breathing and the oxygen, something like that. Everybody is asking oxygen right now. So that was basically the triplet state of the oxygen. But if you flip one of the spin and make a singlet oxygen, so that was the most dangerous molecule in the world. It will oxidize everything. It will oxidize, virus, bacteria, even the human organ. So that was this problem of that. So that was the statement. And with this kind of understanding, we are working in four different areas. One area is like a fundamental of biomolecular interactions. So whatever written in red, so that was basically the basic science, and whatever written in blue, I'm not going to the details of that. So that was the deliverable, like a answer of so what. So this is the photophysics of the material. There we are also making the nanomedicine. Quickly, I'll just go through it. Nanomedicine, biomimetic system, drug delivery system. So there, our idea is to publish the first paper. We want to become the pioneer, and we want to challenge Stanford, Caltech people over there, that being Indian, we also can do something like that. So this is. But there is a some part which is very close to our heart. So it is called development of the instruments. So we're here, we don't want to increase our H index. So we want to go for the high impact factor. So what we consider that we should develop an instrument where a village doctor can use the instrument and save a life. So if one life is saved, then we are telling that we have done something. So that was like that. Briefly, I will tell you that whatever we are doing and something like that. So this is like some publications. I'm not going to the details on that because my lab is open at 24 hours a day and 7 days a week. Even the COVID situation, we got a special permission from the director because we are working COVID related technology, but you know, it has some limitation. Up to 9 o'clock we have to go. So this time, otherwise it was open for 24 hours. So this is the stuff, and some of them are also very industrially appealing, industrially appealing, and some of them are already in the market. I will show you that some of the patents are also there. And somebody may say that this is a very old picture. So this picture was taken recently, and same trend is coming. Like we have medical doctors, biology, physics, and everything like that. So they are working in that way. So this is the nano technology that we are working particularly. So to give you a simple word, we are just joining two different materials. Like this part is the inorganic part. This is the organic part. And why we are putting organic part for a different reason for that. And this we call nano hybrid. And nano hybrid that we are using for the nanomedicine, like whenever we are just making nanomedicine, so we are using these tactics. So this idea of the hybrid again is not very new. So it has been given by some Indian poet, like a Bengali poet, Sukumar Ray, who is the father of the famous Satyajit Ray. So he said that if somebody wanted to make a hybrid elephant with the whale, where they will come up with the Eli whale. So Eli whale is like, this is the elephant and this is the whale. And then it will be a crisis, like, everybody has to compromise. Elephant has to compromise the jungle, and also the whale has to compromise the water, something like that. So this is the technique that we are doing, and it has lots of advantage. I'm not going to the details of the data. And for the nanomedicine and the toxicity, for example, that for the cytotoxicity, which is important, is the size and the zeta potential, like a charge. So we are controlling through the organic part on that, and we are just applying to a different stuff. So let me tell you that if somebody wanted to investigate the interface between inorganic and the organic, the only technique that we'll able to do is a spectroscopy. Like if you do the TEM transmission electron microscopy, you can do the inorganic part. If you do the FTIR, you will do the organic part. So only the information about the interface will come from the spectroscopy. And that was our point, that we are using ultrafast spectroscopy. And what was the beauty about the nanomedicine? Let me tell you that if for the normal medicine, if you just eat, it will go everywhere. And that's why doctor will measure your weight. And although you have the problem in the ear, but doctor will calculate your weight, because some portion of the medicine will go to your ear. and that will also go to your head and hand, leg, everywhere. But if you just can make a nanomedicine like that, functionalize it properly, so you go over there, you inject it, it will go everywhere, but it will be accumulated on the proper organ. And as a result, you can do whatever you like to do, something like that. So targeted drug delivery is very, very important, and that you can do by using nanomedicine. So this is the real recent nanomedicine normally used for the theranostics. Like, it can do the therapy, you can do the diagnostics. This is the iron nanoparticle, iron oxide nanoparticle. So that we did, and we have proved that you can use for PDT, photodynamic therapy, and also you can identify the cancer by MRI contrast agent. So HCT, human colorectal cancer cell, and this is HEK, like a human embryonic kidney cell. See over there that it will be localized in the cancer cells specifically, because we just change the ligand in a very, very specific manner by using the nanotechnology. So that was like our good point about it. Now, this is another stuff that I like to share with you is the nanomedicine for our country. And liver disease, it is increasing. So there was a recent studies by UK scientists. They said that with the increase of the year, the prevalence of all the diseases is declining, but except one disease called liver disease. So liver disease is increasing day by day. And so far, the hepatitis is concerned. India is very much in the alarming region, something like that. So we started working on Mn-containing nanohybrid called manganese-containing nanohybrid. And manganese is an essential element for us. Like, if it is not given properly for the female subject, the problem is that they will have the thyroid problem and so on and so forth. So that's why this is a very essential. And also for the brain development, manganese is really needed for that. So we have lots of history of playing with the Mn-304 nanoparticle. I'm not going to the details on that, but if somebody is interested, I'll be really happy to discuss that, what kind of doing. And we have done the ultrafast spectroscopy. We can identify the LMCT ligand to metal charge transfer. Not only that, we can do DT transitions. So to make long story short, you see the Mn3 plus is a D4 system. And if you just go, if you add this oxygen containing ligand, not only that you will get LMCT, you will get a Young Turner distortion. So both the case, like LMCT and Young Turner distortion, will give you electronic state. And these electronic states are extremely important therapeutically. Like, if you want to use as a medicine, then you should play with this electronic state. So that was very, very important. So a few years back, we first human trial was made with this nanomedicine. And what was the disease particularly we have taken is the hyperbilirubinemia. In simple language, it is called jaundice. So we have used jaundice as a model. And we have trialed with the 12 hyperbilirubinemia patient in PG hospital. So this is one of the biggest hospital in my city. So hyperbilirubinemia is something like very interesting disease. And spectroscopically, the molecule responsible for this kind of disease is called bilirubin. So bilirubin is spectroscopically active. And what we can do we can detect the bilirubin very well. So, bilirubin has a property to cross blood-brain barrier. It can go to the brain very well and immediately collapse the brain activity. And this is called cardiac arrest. So brain will be completely collapsed. So if it is happening for the babies, newborn babies, that also can happen. And that is called the stillborn baby, something like that. And this is really a problem. So we tried with the 12 patients, and we found that after injection of this nanomedicine, 2.5 hours, all the bilirubin is coming to the normal level. Normal level is 0.5 milligram per deciliter. So that was coming over there. But the problem is all of them, all the 12 hyperbilirubinemia patients who are died because of the cardiac arrest, because we didn't have any ethical clearance to inject them. So this experiment we have done, taking their blood out and putting outside, something like that. So then all died. So, if I just go for the history, then history, it is not like that. If some drug is being discovered and coming to the market, it is not a single step. You have to cross so many steps. So next step is the preclinical studies, like you have to work on the mice or the rabbit or the monkey, something like that. So that we have to do. So we started working on that. So you see that we created the hyperbilirubinemia model, jaundice model, and the portal vein of the liver is completely blocked by that, by the disease. And then whenever we are just giving the nanomedicine, it is being cleaned. So that was a good point we did. And so then we got a symptomatic nanomedicine. Symptomatic nanomedicine means, like, you know, standard nanomedicine, standard medicine, if you go for the hepatobiliary problem, doctor will give you and who doesn't want to see you before 6 weeks, because it will go for the hepatic route, and to reduce the bilirubin, it will take some time. But this is like a paracetamol, like you give it, so whenever the bilirubin level is high, it will be down, something like that. And we got a very good paper in nanomedicine, and this title was suggested by the editor himself. And he said it is a safe and symptomatic medicinal use of a functionalized nanomedicine for hyperbilirubinemia treatment of mice. So that was there. So we are very happy, and we are looking for a company, because we have a tablet form, and one drug company already approached to our director, and they wanted to buy and bring this stuff to the market. So that was there, but negotiation is going on, because this is also an API, like an active pharmaceutical industry ingredient. So that was there. And nano as a API is really new in India. So we have to go for several regulatory processes that we are in the process to do like that. And if you just use oral route, so what will happen, not only hyperbilirubinemia, we found the fibrotic liver, which is very common in India, can also be reversed. So that was there. So it has been trial in mice, and we are looking for clinical trial. So this is our recent work, that manganese neurotoxicity, something like that, neuromodulation, and also our immune modulation can also be done with this kind of stuff. And these kind of studies are having some direct relevance to COVID. So that I will come to the later. But quickly, let me show that we have a recent studies that can do the, you know, reverse the Parkinson-like activity in human being. And also it can do the immunomodulation, like it can boost the immunology, it can suppress the immunology, like it can modulate something like that, which is very, very important for the COVID context. So I'll come to that point. So let me show you some of the instruments that we developed over there. And this is the answer that why we wanted to develop this thing. So a few years back in Times of India, there was a news and it said that it's a national problem, like a 200 children death per hour. So not in year, in India. So that they were citing one UNICEF report. And they said that at that time in 2015, something like that, India was number one in children mortality rate. Then next to Nigeria. So let's see that we are fighting Nigeria, that who can produce the more dead children. So not like in wrestling or the football or the cricket, something like that. But what is much more important, we can say that, you know, we are a developing country, we can afford to have this kind of stuff. But what UNICEF said, that most of the dead are preventable death. Preventable death means particularly if you can detect the anemia, jaundice, and oxygen level of the neonatal, for example, then you can prevent lots of fatalities. So that was the most interesting. But what is needed for this little kid is a attention of a doctor. But doctor of my country are really busy, and that's why this thing is remaining. Preventable death cannot be managed, something like that. So this is the statistics. I don't want to bore you with the statistics, because if you just consider the children mortality rate, 55% is being taken care by neonatal death. Like they will not able to see the 22nd day of their life. So before 21st, they will become dead, something like that. If you consider the maternal mortality rate in India, this is also very high, and 37% is taken care by anemia or the hemorrhage. So blood is bleeding and less blood, something like that. If you consider the jaundice, so jaundice is something very, very dangerous. Like if it is not being controlled in 4 to 5 hours of their early life, then it will cross the blood-brain barrier and immediately collapse the activity. If somebody can survive from the carnivorous, the quality of the life of the baby for the whole rest of his life will be very, very dangerous. It will not able to speak. It will not able to communicate. So all ADHD, ASD, like autism spectrum disease, everything is an outcome of this kind of, carnivorous, early stage carnivorous. So neuropsychiatric problem. So that was there. So sometimes, parents wish with the still baby or this baby, abnormal baby, that why he is alive, he should be dead, something like that. So this is like this. But whatever it may be, even a doctor see a baby, so what a doctor will prescribe, that go for the blood test. Otherwise, he will not able to do. So, but taking 2 mL of the blood for each test, for example, like I can give 200 ml, no problem, in a blood bank, even everybody can do. But taking 2 mL blood for testing from the baby, you will feel how painful it is. Like this kind of picture was not shown to their mother. Otherwise, the mother would wish, okay, let my children to go to death, but don't torture, something like that. So this is like a very, very, a thing that is going on. And every day in a hospital visitor, we are facing this kind of problem over there. Now let's see if somebody is being diagnosed with neonatal jaundice, then they will be put inside a Billy light. And every 4 to 6 hours, this torture was given to take this, to know the prognosis of the phototherapy. Otherwise they will go for the dialysis, something like that. So that was this problem. So where is our innovation? Innovation is exactly coming over there, that you do not have to go for the blood test. So just give some light to the conjunctiva. So that was the white portion of our eye, conjunctiva. And light will be retro-reflected back immediately over there. And we have our own software, own hardware, something like that. And if somebody is anemic compared to the normal, the spectrum will be like immediately like that. So this is like somebody is having 14 milligram per deciliter, and this is something like a 4 milligram per deciliter. So you see that the change, dynamic range, that you can detect anything between 3-4, like if somebody is 3 or 4, immediately he or she will be expired, something like that. So this is like an anemia that somebody can detect. If somebody is jaundice, the same wavelength range, jaundice can be detected. And if somebody is having oxygen deficiency, yesterday Bulumoni made a very good statement that this oxygen deficiency in a molecular level is very important in the context of COVID. So exactly we are working on that. And you see that this is the oxyhemoglobin peak and this is deoxyhemoglobin peak. So balance is being perturbed. As a result, you can measure oxygen. So if you just go for the measurement, for example, like in single shot, in a non-contact way, you will able to measure A and J and O. And in Bengali, it is called O-J-O. In Hindi also, it is O-J-O. The meaning is invincible, like you cannot defeat it. So why we said invincible? Because if you can show me any instrument which is doing like three parameters in less than 10 seconds, less than 10 seconds, like a total data collection is 0.5 second and data can be transmitted to 8,000 kilometers, let's say in Germany, in 3 seconds, and the doctor can say what to do in 3 seconds. So less than 3 seconds, 10 seconds, somebody will get the treatment over there without any blood test, without any pain, something like that. So if somebody can show like that, I'm just really by a lunch. So by a lunch, this challenge started coming from roadside dawa. Okay, first I floated the challenge to the student. Then I said, maybe somebody will find it and then I will lose the bet, something like that. So maybe roadside dawa, 500 rupees. But right now, after 10 years, the confidence level built up in such a way that I am ready to pay 5-star hotel lunch to Bulumoni. If Bulumoni can show that somebody is there, like who can defeat our OGO, something like that. So whenever we said like this in Times of India and newspaper Hindu, it came over there, then suddenly the health minister came to my lab and said, Professor Pal, you know, I'm a doctor, so show me your audio. So I was trying to, you know, use my body language to convince him because he's a minister and our director was just standing behind him and something like that, something. But let me tell you that convincing a minister is much more easier than convincing a doctor. Because convincing a minister, they will come, take a picture and they say, oh, yeah, oh, God, oh, God. But he was a doctor. So what he said, very simple with a very big smile, he said, Professor Pal, you know, I'm a doctor. So I know my body parameter, so tested it on myself. So he said, just next to that. So one of my students immediately went and tested on that. So what happened? He tested over there and then he didn't say that whether this is good and bad and something like that. So everybody was curious that what will happen. Like he's a minister, something like that. But I'm a little bit reluctant and I will tell you that why reluctant, because I know that it will be good only. There is no other way. Next day, he sent one message. He tweeted one message to the nation and he said, signing a lamb into eye could rebel bilirubin content in blood, tested in on myself yesterday at S.N. Bose National Center for Basic Sciences. So good point is that he didn't say Bose Institute. If he could have said Bose Institute, we lost our kind of stuff. So lost everything. So he said S.N. Bose National Center. So then I said everything. I got a phone call from PMO's office that what I want. I said, I want to bring this thing to the common person. And they said, okay, join to the national anemia mission. And that's why we did it over there. We have so and so forth. So good stuff started. And why I was a little bit reluctant and I was confident that it will work, because before testing him, it has been trialed to more than 3,000 human beings in different hospitals. We measured bilirubin, we measured hemoglobin, and we got a fantastic results. So our thing is that that for any human being, it will work. And he was a fantastic human being. So interaction was recorded. So my students were very, very charged up with the interaction with Harshavardhanji. So I like to convey my regards to him for giving us a confidence and a chance to prove ourselves. So this is like the logo that one of my students made it. And as I said, that our conclusion is the AUGEO. This is the indigenous instruments. And S.N. Bose, you can find it over there. This is the logo of Professor S.N. Bose. And this is AJO. And this red one, if it is visible, so you can see that this is the blood spectrum. So from the one blood spectrum, you can measure three parameters at one time. No problem with that, which is really very good for comprehensive healthcare. So that was there. And this is like two video. Is it working, Gulumoni, this video?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So the first one was like a national anemia mission. They trial it in Kolkata Center and they took it to Pondicherry, also Jipmer, and they trialed it over there and they got a very good consistency with the blood test, because it was being trialed with the pregnant woman and also the woman, anemic woman who were coming for a blood test. And you can see the AUGEO is working like the AUGEO, no problem with that. So now the technology has been transferred and it is in the market. If some institute wanted to buy, they can pay and can buy from EZRX. So EZRX, the company, so they are doing. And this is the one company who is winning all the grant, Indian grant and everything for the social linkage. Now the basic question somebody is asking, that where is the new metal? Because if you just measure it from the conjunctiva, and neonates are neonates like that. They are very happy to close their eyes like this. They are very happy. Of course, they open their eyes, but with their mother. But the doctors are not the mother. So that was this problem. So this thing, getting the access to the conjunctiva is really a problem for the neonatal. And the problem is that, but they are very happy to give the thumbs up, like if they say, okay, do it like that. So they can give you the finger. So we made a technology. So this is the first international patent, particularly from S.N. Bose National Center, that that we can measure the hyperbilirubinemia for the neonatal from the thumb. So from the thumb, from the nails bit, we can measure it, and it has been trial more than 3,000 new NETA. So it is working fantastically from bilirubin level 1, 2 to bilirubin level 16, no problem with that. So one Brazilian company was interested to go for the technology transfer. So they just came from the Brazil after the publication and after signing the NDA, non-disclosure agreement, we showed them that how it is working. I think the video is working. So he's Dr. Macero. He's the owner of this stuff. So he came from the Brazil. And my doctor collaborators, my doctor students are there in the hospital. So you will be able to see the how easy it is. Like they will just take the thumb. They will take the thumb and put the light. And immediately, in 0.5 seconds, doctor can get this report on their mobile. So he is Arnob, one of my MD students. He is doing PhD right now in neonatology. So, and you see that he is taking the thumb.
Sir, I think we don't have much more slides, right?
Done?
No, sir. If you are left with only very few slides, then you can carry on.
Okay. No problem. I have done this. So this is like a non-touch painless kind of stuff. So that came in DST stuff. And now this is the COVID. This is the COVID. So we developed a technology, and this is the mask. And this mask particularly is very important. Like if you ask any person who is carrying the mask either in the chin or in the top, so they will answer at this one of the four that they are having the problem with breathing, rebreathing of the carbon dioxide and everything. So we have a solution for that. We have a long lasting sanitizer, something like that. So this has recently been launched, and our director is there. So right, I have to tell that he's our director, because earlier there was a proverb that face says it all. But right now, if you have the face mask, then face doesn't show it all. For example, that Tonusi Sadas Gupta was there here, and Bulumoni only recognized her through her dress, not the face. So she said that she has a same dress, like as Professor Sadhuskap Das Gupta is having. So that's why there. And she is our register. He is our director. So he's having both sealed and both sizer, something like that. So this is the another thing. I'm not going to the details. I know that I'm just running out of time. So this is the nanoceutical fabric prevents something. So that we did in collaboration with Professor Tonusi Sardas Gupta. So this is nothing but a one CDC's comment that nobody can use a bulb containing mask. So we made a fabric that can catch the coronavirus and also can destroy the coronavirus like that. So it is done on the bacterial model. So this is the another stuff that we collaborated with our director, Professor S. K. Ray, and also Tonusi Sardas Gupta. This is related to recycling of PPE. Right now, PPE is being used for marriage, like you see, and also, but they are, after marriage, they are throwing it out on the road. So that is becoming an environmental problem. So whatever we did, we have used a triboelectroceutical fabric. Like if you rub your hand like that way, some electrical power will be generated, and also HOCl will be generated. As a result, mini battery will be generated inside that, and you can clean the virus or the bacteria. So technology which is waiting for the market is like, that is very much related to COVID. Like if you ask, this is the recent nephrology review. They said that comorbidity of COVID-19 is like a CKD patient. So CKD patient means chronic kidney disease. They are going for the dialysis, and their immune is being suppressed. And whatever they emphasize, that their frequent hospital visit is making them vulnerable for the COVID. So we developed a machine that sodium and the potassium can be measured from the saliva. no problem that, and this is a simple technology. I'm not going to the details on that. You have to come to see. And we said that this is NALIC, sodium, lithium, potassium, that all the three stuff can be measured at one time from the optical emission spectroscopy. So that was there. And recently we developed a thing that you can do it from your saliva, no problem with that. And this is the data. So conventional technique is a painful, another our technique is very, very easy, friendly. So now I want to show you that COVID has relation with the oral health, because that's why you said the teeth and the oral health. Like if your teeth and oral health is not good, people said that you may have the COVID infection. So that was there. And so this is the CDC guideline that don't visit to the dentist very frequently, something like that. Aerosol will come and then it will infect, something like this. And what this is the new result, that oral health is also important. If somebody is having excess fluoride or the arsenic, they may have an oral problem. And if somebody is having the fluoride or the arsenic, their immune will be suppressed and they may have the COVID. So that was related with this. So this portion was not known earlier. So, and also like if you have excess fluoride, then you will have the fluorosis, so dental scaling. And that was very much relevant to Assam. Government said that water in 14 districts in Assam affected by arsenic and fluoride. So that was very, very careful. Somebody has to be. So we collaborated with Tanushree Sardas Gupta and we made a very good nanosensor. And that nanosensor will detect the fluoride in PPB level, even if it is being cleaned by Nalgonda method, something like that. So I'm not going to the details on that. So we have advantage of using our sensor compared to the conventional. This is our sensor called PEPLU. PEPLU means iron-based fluoride sensor. So this is right now under trial in Rajasthan. So Rajasthan is most affected states in India. So that was there. We are also working on the detection of urinary bladder cancer. And this instrument we call the speculation. So the spectroscopy-based urinary lesion detection. And if somebody is having the cancer, they will have this signal. Somebody is normal, then this signal, something like that. So we are having this. And this is also working in one of the hospitals in Scotland called Dundee Hospital, something like that. So this is the way forward. Right now, whatever we are doing, we are also solving one problem that in 3 days back in Nature, that was a news, that's that COVID research, a year scientific milestone. Nature waded through the literature on the coronavirus and summarized the key papers in this thing. So you can see how the coronavirus were detected and how the vaccine was made, something like that. So this is everything was a very good way summarized. But there was a confusion. Lots of confusion is also coming. And the confusion is basically said, the first generation vaccine of COVID-19 is rolling out over the world, but are these vaccines able to withstand the force of the viral evolution? So like that. So virus is always evolving. And this is somebody should think about it, that AstraZeneca, Pfizer, they made this vaccine. But in some countries, the Oxford vaccine completely stopped or they halt the distribution because this mutation, they will not able to do anything. So this is the vaccine and they stopped it in, I think that South Africa, something like that. So that variety is completely different than the original variety. And that's why this is not working over there. So that is the good question, that whether vaccine is useful and how useful it is, something like that. So that was this thing. So what we are working, we thought that vaccine has a limitation because of this kind of, so if we can make a medicine out of that, then what will happen? So we started making a nano medicine of the COVID-19. It was being highlighted to Ministry of Science and Technology a few months back. And this is the paper that we said that the role of nanomedicine in redox mediated healing of molecular level. So we said that if you can modulate the body redox, not only we can heal lots of problem, we can modulate the immunology. So immuno separation and then operation and separation is possible. And after our publication in 2019, as you can recognize, several publications came and they said redox modulating agent in the treatment of viral infection. So they said without citing our paper, so that was good. But there is some wise persons. This is the Nature Reviews, by the way, Molecular Cell Biology. This is the Nature Review, which state a statement which that I want to show you. He said, on the new front of redox medicine, the emerging field of ROS-based nanomedicine involving nanomaterials with ROS regulating properties holds promise for optimized therapeutic efficacies. So that's it. And they cited, for example, 292. So 292 is Odikari and Mondal. So that is my student. So they exactly said that this is a new class of medicine that was coming to the market, which will be able to do ROS modulation, something like that. So before I stop, I know that everybody, Vandana, Pudumuni is eager to stop me. But before I stop, I think that I should, say my regards to Professor Jagtap. I don't know if Sir is still there or not, but let me, convey my deep regard to him. Because of him, I'm just I will able to share my activities to you. And this is the evidence that how he was visiting my lab. So he came, and again, let me introduce. He is Professor Jagatap, because with the mask, face not always say everything. And he is Professor S.K. Ray, our director. So he just first came and theoretically wanted to understand everything. But convincing him is exactly as difficult as Professor Harshavardhan. So he wanted to see each and everything. So time for me was the 5 minutes that the director said, but he was not going to the other lab. So he was going all the details that how we are making our instruments and who is making and what is the physics on it. He trying to understand everything. Then after that, some miracle happened. So we wrote down our understanding on the board, digital board, and he agreed to sign that whatever our understanding is there, he's signing on that. So you see that he is signing on the on our writing, and this is his signature. So who can recognize his signature? He's a very famous person. So that is there. So he signed it over there. So that was a story that he said, and he also promised us that he will again visit and he will go to the details of the instruments that we are developing. So with this, I think that I should stop really right now with a hope and the promise, as Gurudev said, chitto jetha vaishunno, then the limit will be the infinity. And I was telling that at that time he was not sure that our country is ready or not. That's why he said, let my country awake. And in Bengali, he said, Bharotere sei sorbe koro jagorito. And I was telling to Bulumoni that this is also in Ahamiya, that the same stuff, like everybody can read the script. So with this thing, let me thank you. Thank you very much for your kind presence.
Thank you, sir. It was really an excellent piece of research work from application point of view for common man, as you said. So the presentation was also very nice. So I would like to again thank you for the nice presentation as well as for showing the research work going on in your lab. So we really hope that we'll have opportunities to interact with you again. And also I believe that our students may sometime also get some opportunity to work with you. So now I like to transfer some of the queries raised by the participants in the Zoom platform first, then I'll go to the YouTube. So the first query was made by one of our students, Mohit Paul. He was asking, does ultrafast spectroscopy have any specific range of frequency?
Yeah, Yes, it does have a specific frequency ultrafast. So whatever we are doing, we are just using the visible light, and visible light with a particular wavelength. So this wavelength is having the frequency. And for example, if you just divide 400 nanometer by the velocity of light, you can get the frequency. So that was the frequency we are using in the visible light even. We are exciting UV light, we are exciting the molecule with the UV light, and then we are detecting their activity in the visible light. So it does have the frequency.
Okay, I hope, Mohit, it is clear to you. So next one comment from one of my colleagues, Dr. Binita Patak. She is saying that I am very much happy to see this instrument, AJO, as you discussed. And a big, big thanks to you, sir, for keeping by this instrument the newborn babies away from the repeated painful bilirubin test. Is this instrument being used widely in India?
Yes, actually, after the technology transfer, unfortunately, we have very little control on the company. Of course, we have done through NRDC. And he is particularly like whoever is an Indian company, he is selling the AJO to the different government agency, because he was supposed to get an order from Tripura government for anemia mission and everything, because they have lots of stuff. So he's just exploring the possibility. And whoever transferred the technology for the neonatal jaundice, like for the neonatal, they are waiting because of the COVID, it delayed a little bit, but they wanted to not come from India. They wanted to come from Japan and Canada, because they have some manufacturing unit over there. So they wanted to come through that. As an Indian entity, they will make it, but they will do the other countries also. So that's why they are waiting for that.
Okay, sir. One more question from Siddhartha Pratim Haradas. He is one of my colleagues. Sir, how does the fluorescent dyes find applications in the field of nanomedicine?
All right. So fluorescent dye, for example, gets nanomedicine kind of stuff, because for the theranostic applications, nanomedicine will cure the disease, and dye will tell you where the medicine is going. It will be a tracker. So diagnosis will be done for the fluorescence, and nanomedicine will cure the disease. So for the theranostic application, like in one go, diagnosis and the therapy, so fluorescence dye is a very good idea.
Okay, so one more question from one of our students, Abhishek Borua. He is asking how by light bilirubin levels are detected by fingertips. Can it be used in adults?
Can you repeat, Gulumuni? I cannot hear you.
Yeah, it is written how by light bilirubin levels are detected by fingertips. I did not understand, because you did not show it. Yeah. So can it be used in adults?
Yeah. So that's a very good question, even the stuff. Let me tell you that for the bilirubin, the way we are detecting the bilirubin, we are just giving the light on the fingertip, and the light is penetrating few micron over there and touching the vascular bed, like a blood vessels, so it is touching and taking the information from the blood, and we are measuring the bilirubin. The problem of the adult with the fingertip is that adult has a different skin tone, and also the nail height and nail thickness is different. Like it is different from female to male, something like that. But for the neonatal, whenever they are not going to 21 days, they are having the same thickness. There is no male, no female, something like that. So that was this problem. So then for the adult, it will be like a different calibration for the different person and something. So it will become the instrument to be very complicated.
So, sir, one more student, Arnab Paik, is asking how DRDO's anti-COVID drug 2-deoxy-D-glucose going to work? How it is effective in comparison to COVID vaccine?
Repeat the question one more time.
how DRDO's anti-COVID drug, DRDO's anti-COVID drug 2-deoxy-D glucose is going to work, how it is effective in comparison to COVID vaccine.
I can tell only the how the nanomedicine was working. I am not aware about this this DRDO's work, because whether DRDO.
Sir, actually, yeah, recently I have got in news that some oral vaccine has been actually prepared in India. So I think he might be asking about this. So today only in the news I got this, some oral vaccine has come up. So he's asking about he just want to know how it will be comparable in
If it is the oral, for example, then it will be like a simple, like a polio. Polio has the two variety. One is the injectable one and another is the oral one. So the same strategy, like a delivery vehicle will be different and somebody can really use it. But I am not aware about the new drug that he said in DRDO.
Okay, so it's a recent news, actually today's news. So one more student, Tirtha Kalita, is asking, in this time of global pandemic, should we restrict ourselves to Atmanirbhar Bharat or should we look for the solutions in global scale?
Yeah, so Atmanirbhar Bharat in this condition is not the choice at all. It is a mandate. So I want to tell you like that. So what Prime Minister, our honorable Prime Minister, anticipated long back, that it is not like that everything that you have to make. In our abstract also, I wrote it over there. But you should have the ability that given the crisis, you have to make it. For example, US completely stopped the Indian person to go over there. They stopped giving us the material for the vaccine production. And our people is going to UK or something like that to build a factory for that kind of stuff. Now, this is unprecedented. We are not prepared for that. But if we could if we could take the Atmanirbhar Bharat in the right sense, then we would face this kind of in future. So that was my point, that this is right now a choice, no?
Yeah, so one more student, Mohit Paul, is asking, what are some of the government certified nanomedicines?
Yeah, so government certified nanomedicines are there, and Drexol, you can write it down, Drexol. So it is like a doxy, it is basically a nano formulation. It was a doxyribution is an anti-cancer drug. It work in a breast cancer very well. And also they put it inside a vesicle. So that was a USMA drug, government certified. So they certified 57 or something like that. I forgot the number, but this is a very good question. So Drexol is one of the registered nanomedicine, but this is not an inorganic nanoparticle. So there is an organic vesicle, like a phosphatidylcholine vesicle, and inside that is a doxorubution.
Yeah, sir, these are the questions from Zoom. One more last question from my side before taking the questions from YouTube. Sir, as you were saying about AZO, can we, I mean, instead of taking the measurement for the three parameters, anemia level, jaundice, and oxygen level, can it be used for measuring only, say, the oxygen level parameter, or means, can it be operated?
Definitely, Bulumani. It is a very good question. Actually, we made a three patent, and the one company bought the three patent at one time. But it is a completely three different patent, and it has been trial in a different time. So that means oxygen can easily be monitored, and we are just also working in a different context. Like somebody asked that whether it will be. It will work for the adult nose or not. We are trying to work from the pump, and we are just in a calibration mode, that for the woman and for the man and everything, it is working or something like that. Yes, yeah. Only
so,
oxygen.
So what what is the tentative cost of the instrument? Because already we are using the oximeters, right? So we know the price of that.
So there is a two kinds of price, let me tell you. So one price is like installation cost. It's like you buy and then you do. So the market price installation cost that they are selling is about 2,75,000, something like that. And if you just every day do it 200 patients, and if you charge them, let's say 23 paisa, let's say 25 paisa, let's say one rupee for that charge, the total ROI, the return of the investment will happen in 1.5 years, like all these things. So they are not going for a selling model, they are going for the rental model. Like and somebody like Bajaj Finance or something like that, they are also financing that they can finance, you can get it. Whenever you will get the money, you can return them back something. So because they are going for a rental model for a different idea, it's called data will be owned by the company, where for the demographic strategy, they can also advise the company in a different way.
Yeah. So, sir, quickly, I will take some questions from the YouTube, where Abhinav Chaudhary is asking how fundamental research projects like India-based neutrino observatory will help India to grow.
Neutrino-based observatory.
India-based neutrino observatory.
Why don't you answer?
No, he is asking in context with the growth of India.
Right. I think that Professor Jagatap is the right person, because we learned a lot about the stuff. So maybe...
actually, what I understand from this question is that as you people are involved in the application-based research, right? And one group is there in the core physics research, which is the fundamental research. So his question is related to that, how this core research or basic research is going to help in the growth of India. But definitely, from my understanding is that before doing the application, you have to go through the understanding of the things, right? So fundamental research is always behind the success of any application-based research. So definitely it will help in the growth of India.
My point is that if you can justify that why you are doing the fundamental research and immediately delivery, like that if you do the fundamental research and this will be the deliverable, or this is the application domain that we are doing. We are also working on a lots of fundamental research on that. Mm-hmm. But we know any person ask us that where is the application, we can tell that. For that reason, we are working.
Yeah. So one question from our student, Jivan Upadhyay, he is asking, science and technology is all about collaboration irrespective of borders. Will the idea of Atmanirbhar Bharat become an obstacle?
Actually, Atmanirbhar Bharat doesn't say that you should not collaborate. Of course, you will collaborate, but with your own identity. Like with your atto-vishwas, with your self-confidence. The collaboration is not like that you are becoming the burden to somebody. It is not the collaboration. Then it is something else. But collaboration means you will contribute, I will contribute, they will also contribute. And then mutually something will grow, something like that. So that was my understanding only. I don't know. Yeah. Collaboration doesn't mean that we'll just give everything to them.
Yeah, he is again asking that should the expenditure or funding or budget in case of the R&D section in India be increased to compete in the global scenario?
Policymaker that I learned that again, Professor Jagatap was three times he said in the Indian policy making, whether fundamental research will get more money or the application driven, then again, I will request him to comment on that.
Yeah. So one question for Dr. D.A.R. Babu, how can dye visible light come from organ?
I'm sorry?
How can he's asking, how can dye, D-Y-E, dye, visible light come from organ?
Yeah, because there is a lots of dyes that is in our organ. For example, that vitamin B2, riboflavin, if you excite it to 400 nanometer or 450 nanometer, then you will get a very intense green light, 520, something like that. So this is the dye, but this is the vitamin. If you consider the vitamin A, like a beta carotene, for example, then it is fluorescent, extremely fluorescent, something like that. If you consider NADPH, nicotinamide, adenine, dinucleotide phosphate, so that was also part of our body, and it is everywhere in the organ, so it is there. So all the fluorescence are categorized in one term called autofluorescence. Like our body cell also give you the fluorescence because of this kind of dyes.
Yeah. So I think we should stop taking more questions because we have already exceeded the time limit. But I have seen some more questions in the chat box, but definitely they can interact with Professor Samir Kumar Pal sir through email. I think he will be definitely answering your questions there. So in this way, we have come to the last part of the event. So before concluding, let us thank the organizers for giving us the opportunity for hosting the event. We hope that we will get such opportunities to work with you again in future. Especially, I would like to thank Professor Bandana Nanal, EIFM Mumbai, for all the communications. Thank you, madam. We would also like to thank our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dibrugarh University, Professor L.K. Nath sir, for his support and guidance for hosting the event. We thank the Registrar, Dibrugarh University, Professor Jiten Hazarika sir, for showing his interest and his encouragement for hosting the event. We thank the speaker, Professor Samir Kumar Pal sir, for his wonderful lecture and the valuable time that he spent with us. We hope we will get the chance to interact with you again, sir. We thank all the participants of the Zoom platform and the YouTube live streaming of the event. So in this way, we have come to the end of the program. Thank you all. So now I would like to request Professor Vandana Madam to give her comments. Over to you, Madam.
Thank you, Bulumoni, and thanks to all the authorities of the Dibrugarh University. Thanks to Professor Samir Kumar Pal for a wonderful lecture. And yes, we hope that you will stay engaged with IPMR. And I'm sure the students would have got a flavor of what you can do in the application of research, what wonderful things you can do about it. So we look forward to some of them taking this path. Thank you, and everybody take care and stay safe in this era.
So thank you all. Goodbye from our side.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Okay.